we have discussed the contraction mapping principle in the last class. Let us recall what it says once again. That is, if X is a complete metric space and F is a contraction map on X, then F has a unique fixed point. Now this principle, as I said, has applications in several areas, in particular differential equations. One of the standard theorem about the existence of differential equations, what is called Picard's theorem, uses this contraction mapping principle. One can also ask how does one come across these contraction mappings, and one of the very standard ways of constructing these contraction maps is by using what you have learned in the undergraduate calculus as mean value theorem. That is, if you remember what is a mean value theorem, that is what it says, that if you take, suppose f is a function which has derivatives, and suppose you take say two points x and y, and suppose f has derivatives in the interval containing x and y, then you know that fy minus fx, this can be written as some f prime at z multiplied by, let us say, y minus x, assuming that x is less than y, okay, where z lies between x and y, z is some point which lies between x and y. Now suppose f is such that, suppose f is differentiable, let us say on some interval ab, okay, and suppose for all points in ab, suppose we know that absolute value of the derivative is less than or equal to some number alpha, which is less than or equal to less than 1, then we can show using this that that map f is a contraction map, okay. That is, and suppose we know this, that is f prime at x is less than or equal to alpha, and this alpha is strictly less than 1, and suppose this happens for every x in ab, okay. Then using that, what we can say is that mod fy minus fx, then we can say that mod fy minus fx less than or equal to alpha times mod y minus x, okay. This will happen for every xy in ab, okay. And that means, which is same as saying that f is a contraction map on this closed interval ab, okay. F is a contraction map on this closed interval ab, and we have seen that a closed real line as a metric space is complete, and a closed subset of a metric space is again complete. So any closed interval is an example of a complete metric space. So if you take a map which satisfies this property on any closed interval, then that should have a fixed point, okay, unique fixed point. Okay, another thing that we discuss about this, remember all this started with the some certain special types of uniformly continuous functions, okay. Another type that we discuss was what we call isometry, okay. Look, let us again recall what was an isometry. Suppose we take say two metric spaces x, so let us say xd and y rho. Let us recall that we had said that f from x to y is called isometry if it preserves the distance, okay. Isometry, as the word means, the map preserves the distances, okay. That is, what should happen is that if you take say any two points x and y here and look at the distance between fx and fy, then that should be same as distance between x and y, okay. So that is for every xy in x. In other words, isometry is a distance preserving map, and what we have already observed is that isometry will always be 1-1, okay. If f is an isometry, it will always be 1-1, okay. It may or may not be onto, okay, and if it is onto, then we say that x and y are isometric to each other, okay. If there exists an onto isometry from x to y, then we say that the two metric spaces x and y are isometric to each other, and we also seen that if the two metric spaces are isometric to each other, then as metric spaces they are essentially the same. We can disregard the difference between the two, any two isometric space. Only thing that differs is that the names or labels of the elements change. Otherwise, the distance between the two elements are exactly same. As whatever happens in X, the same thing should happen in Y, and whatever property X holds, the same property will be there for Y also. Okay. So, in view of this, what is usually done is that, see, let us now take one case. Now, suppose F is an isometry. Okay. Suppose F is an isometry. Okay. Suppose F from X to Y is an isometry. It may or may not be onto, okay, but it, that is, it may or may not be onto Y, but this, it will always be onto f of x. Okay. F of x will be a subset or subspace of Y, so f from x to fx will always be onto. Okay, and so these two spaces x and fx, this is from x to fx, this is a onto isometry. Okay, so we need, so we can disregard the difference between x and fx. Okay, and fx is contained in Y. Okay, fx is contained in Y. So this kind of thing, we can say that we express this by saying that x is isometrically embedded in Y. Okay, such a thing is called isometric embedding. Okay, this space fx. Okay, as I said, that we did not regard that x and fx are different. We can regard x and fx are the same. So in by means of this isometry, we can regard x as a subspace of Y. We can regard x as a subspace of Y. Okay. Now let us say that Y is complete. Okay, suppose Y is complete, X may or may not be complete. Suppose X is any arbitrary space and Y is complete, then regarding this fx as a subset of Y, we can always say that we can look at fx closure. Okay, fx closure. Okay, fx closure will be complete if Y is complete. Fx closure will be complete. Okay, so even if X is not a complete metric space, okay, fx closure is a complete metric space, and it contains x as a dense subspace. Okay, it contains x as a dense subspace. So such a metric space is called a completion of x. Okay, right, it is called completion of x. Okay, what is meant by completion? Again, let me repeat, it's a complete metric space which contains the given metric space as a dense subspace. Okay, that is called completion of a metric space. Okay. Now, obvious question is whether such a completion exists, given any, or can every metric space be completed? Okay, right. And is such a completion unique? Okay. Then the answer is yes. Okay, we can always find a complete metric space which contains the given metric space as a dense subspace. And then the completion is unique in certain sense. Okay, it is unique. What we say is that it is unique up to isometry. That is, if you take any two completions of the given metric space, then those are isometric to each other. And since, in view of our idea of not regarding isometric spaces as different, so we can say that up to isometry the completion is unique. Okay. Now, how to go about constructing this completion? Okay, that problem I shall not discuss right now. That will postpone for some time. Okay. Now let us go to next property of a metric space. Okay, that is next property that a metric space may or may not have, or subsets of a metric space may or may not have. That is a property that is called connectedness. Okay. So here, let us say we are given a metric space XD. And we are looking at a subset A of X. Okay. And we want to say what is meant by saying that A is connected or A is not connected. Okay. A is connected or A is not connected. Now, roughly speaking, a connected set should mean that it's a single piece. It's a single piece. For example, suppose the set is like this, say some points here and some points here, then obviously we will regard this as not connected or disconnected. Only thing is that what we feel intuitively about connectedness, we have to make little more precise by giving the correct definition in the context of any metric spaces. Okay, so the way in which it is defined is as follows. Okay, now, okay, it so turns out that it is simpler to define what is meant by not connected. Okay, so we shall define that first, and then we shall come to connectedness. Okay, so we say that A is said to be disconnected. Disconnected means not connected. Is said to be disconnected okay. You can keep this picture in mind for defining what is meant by disconnected. What should happen is that we should be able to find two open sets, okay, two open sets such that A is contained in those two open union of the two open sets, and that those two open sets are disjoint, okay, should be disjoint, and intersection of each of those sets with A should be non-empty. Okay, so let me again repeat: A is said to be disconnected if there exists disjoint open sets. Open sets G1, G2 in X such that. What are the requirements? First thing is that, okay, let me write spell out complete such that A is contained in G1 union G2. Okay. Second requirement is that G1 and G2 are disjoint. Okay. Okay. We did not write again, but anyway, let us emphasize that. Okay. G1 intersection G2 is empty. Okay. And A intersection G1. And A intersection G2 both must be non-empty. Okay, so A intersection G1 is non-empty, and A intersection G2 is also non-empty. For example, suppose we take a set consisting of these two regions in either in the complex plane or in R2, then you can obviously find some open set G1 containing this, some open set G2 containing this, the disjoint sets. So such a set is disconnected, right? So, and if A is, once having defined what is meant by a disconnected set, now we can define a connected set is the one which is not disconnected. So, so we will say that A is connected if it is not disconnected. Connected if it is not disconnected. Of course, you may not find it in this way in all books. Okay, in a book you may find what is first it is defined what is meant by connected set. Okay, but then what will be the definition that such two open sets don't exist? Okay, that is what is suppose I wanted to without going through this procedure. Suppose I want to define what is meant by a connected set. Then what I would have to say is that A is connected if there don't exist two disjoint two open sets satisfying all these properties. Or what is the meaning of that? If you take any two open sets, at least one of the requirement is violated. Okay, that is the meaning of connected. All right. Now, what are the obvious examples of connected sets or disconnected sets? Disconnected set we have already seen. Okay. As far as connected set is concerned, suppose you just take a single point. Okay. Suppose a set consists of only one point. Okay, then obviously this last thing cannot happen, that is G1 and G2 are disjoint and A intersection G1 and A intersection G2 is non-empty, that sort of thing cannot happen, right? So a set consisting of one point is always connected, okay? Whatever be the metric space, a singleton set is always connected, okay, right? So let us, that is a standard example. So singletons and say it is connected in any metric space. Okay. Of course, a set can have more than one point and still be connected, but we shall see those examples little later. Okay. On the other hand, suppose you consider a discrete metric space. Okay. Suppose X is a discrete metric space, and of course, containing if it contains only one point, obviously it is connected. Okay. But suppose X is a discrete metric space containing more than one points. Okay. Is it clear that X must be disconnected? Because you can just take, let us say, one point and then other as the complement. Because in a discrete metric space, you know that every subset is open. Okay. Right. So you just write X as a union of two open sets. That is, for example, you can take say G1 as just one point and G2 as its complement. Okay. Then that will satisfy all these properties. Okay. And of course, as a special case of this, when A is the whole of X, okay, when we say metric space X itself is disconnected, instead of this X is contained in G1 union G2, it will be X equal to G1 union, because G1 union G2 will always be a subset of X. So, and if X is also contained in G1 union G2, it simply means that X is equal to G1 union G2. It means that if you can write X as a disjoint union of two non-empty open sets, okay, then X is a disconnected metric space. Okay. Otherwise, it is connected. If you cannot write X as a disjoint union of two non-empty open sets, then X is a connected metric space. Okay. All right. And it is fairly straightforward to prove that this connectedness is a property which doesn't depend on whether you regard A as a subset of X or A as a subset of itself. Okay, because we know that A itself is a metric space. Okay. So we can say one might think that there may be some difference between regarding A as a connected set, as a matrix, as a subset of A and as a subset of X. Okay, we have seen that kind of difference exists in open sets, closed sets, etc. Okay, right? Whether you regard A as a subset of A itself, that will be always open. Okay, but if you take A as a subset of X, it may or may not be open. Okay, but in case of connectedness, that is not the thing. Okay, A is connected or not connected. That does not depend on whether you regard A as a subset of X or any, or A itself, or any set lying between A and X. That can be proved, but we shall not go into proof of that right now. Okay. Now let us come back to the again very most familiar metric space, namely the real line. Okay. What are the connected sets in the real line? Okay. And there we have the most satisfactory theorem or most satisfactory answer. Intervals are the connected sets in the real line, and those are the only connected sets. So let us say, let us write that as a theorem. Okay. Okay. Let us say that let A be a subset of R. By the way, what about empty set? For example, can such a thing happen if A is empty? Right? It's not possible, right? So an empty set is connected set. Okay, that is virtually or trivially it's a connected set. Okay. All right. So let A be a subset of R. Okay. Then what the theorem says, A is connected if and only if A is an interval. Okay. Then. So this gives a complete description of connected sets in the real line. Okay. A is connected if and only A is an interval. Okay. Now let me recall what is, we have seen that how an interval is defined. Okay. We have seen that interval means, when we set a set is an interval, that if you take two points X and Y, if X and Y belong to A, then all the points lying between X and Y must also belong to A. Okay, that is the definition of an interval. Okay, all right. Let us first prove it this way. Okay, suppose A is connected, and we want to prove that A is an interval. Okay, all right. Suppose A is connected. All right. Okay. Now, if A is not an interval, suppose A is not an interval, we should get a contradiction, right? suppose A is not an interval, okay. If A is not an interval, what should happen? There should exist 3 points, let us say x, y and z, okay. Let us say x less than z less than y, such that x and y belong to A but z does not belong to A, okay. Okay. So let us say then there exists, let us say then there exists x, y, z in R, there exists x, y, z in R such that x less than z less than y, x, y belong to A, okay, and z does not belong to A, right. Okay. All right. Now what we can do is that we can construct 2 open sets G1 and G2 satisfying all those properties listed there, okay. Okay. So let us say, so for example consider G1 is equal to let us say minus infinity to z, open interval minus infinity to z, okay, and G2 is equal to open interval z to infinity. Okay. Are G1 and G2 non-open sets? They are open intervals, so hence open sets. Okay. Are they non-empty? Obviously, I mean they are infinite sets. Okay. Okay. Is this true that A is contained in G1 union G2? Right. Okay. In fact, G1 union G2 contains the whole of R except this point z. G1 union G2 is the whole of R except this point z, and that point z is not in A, okay. So A is contained in G1 union G2, okay. And what about A intersection G1? A intersection G1 contains X, okay. A intersection G1 contains, so X belongs to A intersection G1, so that is non-empty, okay. And A intersection G2 that contains Y, okay. So Y belongs to A intersection G2, so that is non-empty, okay. So we have found sets G1 and G2 satisfying all these properties here, okay, right, okay. So that means A is not connected, A is disconnected, and that is a contradiction, okay. We had started with the assumption that A is connected, okay. So every connected subset of real line is an interval. Let us now see how we can prove it the other way. Okay. So we shall discuss this proof again tomorrow. So for the time being, we shall assume that whenever A is an interval, A is also connected. Okay. So whatever is the missing parts, we shall discuss this again in tomorrow's lecture. Okay. Let us proceed further. Next, what we want to say is that what happens to the images of the connected sets under the continuous functions, okay. So let us look at this, okay. So what the theorem, suppose x d and y rho are metric spaces, and f from x to y is connected. Then suppose you take a connected set in A, then its image in Y is also connected, okay. So that is what we want to prove, okay. So if A is contained in X is connected, then F of A is also connected. basically the whole proof depends, okay, of course this is a important theorem about the connectedness. The whole proof depends basically on the fact that inverse images of open sets are open under continuous functions, okay, which is what we have seen sometime earlier, okay. So suppose f of a is not connected, okay, then we shall find there should exist open set g1 g2 satisfying all those properties which we have written, and then consider their inverse images, okay. They will do the same thing with respect to a, okay, and that will show that a is not connected, and that will be a contradiction, okay. So let us go through that proof, okay. So suppose f of a is not connected, f of a is not connected, okay, then there exists open sets g1 g2 such that, okay, whatever is required, g1 intersection g2 is empty. F of A is contained in g1 union g2, then F of A intersection g1 is non-empty, and F of A intersection g2 is also non-empty, okay. What we do after this is that, of course, these open sets g1 and g2, those are in Y, open sets g1 and g2 in Y, okay, because f of a is a subset of Y, okay. So what we shall do now is that consider the inverse images of g1 and g2 under f, okay, and then just rewrite these equations in terms of those, okay. So then first look at F inverse g1, okay. Is F inverse g1 non-empty, okay? Why F inverse g1 is non-empty? Because this shows that FA intersection g1 is non-empty, so there should exist some x such that fx is in g1, okay, that f, because suppose, okay, suppose that fx, fa is a set of all fx of the form x is in a, its intersection with g1 is non empty, that means there exists some x in a such that fx intersection g1 is non empty, so f inverse g1 is non empty, so f inverse g1 is, okay, first of all f inverse g1 and f inverse g2 are open sets in X. Why they are open? Because g1 and g2 are open in Y and f is continuous, okay. And we have seen that inverse image of an open set under a continuous function is open, okay. Okay. All right, now look at this equation, f of a is contained in g1 union g2. F of A is contained in g1 union g2, so that means that A is contained in F inverse of g1 union g2, okay, right. So this means A is contained in F inverse of g1 union g2, okay, right. And we can always say that F inverse of g1 union g2, that is same as, in fact it is same as F inverse g1 union F inverse g2. But we can certainly say it is contained in F inverse g1 union F inverse g2, okay. Actually this is equal, okay, actually this is equal. So A is contained in F inverse g1 union F inverse g2, both these are open sets, okay. Then what about A intersection F inverse g1, okay, that is where we come back, look at this point again, okay. If A intersection g1 is non-empty, it means there exists some x such that fx belongs to g1, okay, there is some x such that fx belongs to g1, so that x should be in A as well as in f inverse g1, okay. See, fa intersection, let me repeat, fa intersection g1 is non empty means there exists some x in A such that fx is in g1, okay, so that x is in A and also in f inverse g1, okay, so which is same as saying that A intersection f inverse g1 is non empty, okay, A intersection f inverse g1 is non empty, okay. And in a similar way, we can say that A intersection f inverse g2 is also non empty, okay, A intersection f inverse g2 is also non empty. But that is a contradiction, okay, that shows that A is not connected, okay, so this means A is not connected, okay. Now, as a special case of this, okay, if this second space Y is real line, if the second space Y is real line, then it means that if you take a connected set in X, okay, its image must be a connected set in R, and which we have just now proved that connected sets in R must be in intervals, okay. So that means image of a connected set under a continuous function will always be an interval, okay, image of a connected set under a continuous real valued function, okay, will always be an interval, okay. And this theorem, of course, which follows immediately from here, okay, it is a special case, and the previous theorem is well known as an intermediate value theorem, okay. Intermediate value theorem. So let us say that let XD be a metric space and F from X to R be continuous. Okay. Of course, when I say nothing more about R, it means it is with the usual metric, okay, right. If we use some other metric on R, that will be specifically said, okay. This is something I mentioned earlier also, okay. So if A is a connected subset of X, connected subset of X, then F of A is an interval. Okay. Of course, this follows immediately from this, okay. As such, in a normal course, we should have simply called this as a corollary, okay. Corollary of this, because no new ideas are involved here. If A is connected, F of A is connected, and since F of A is a subset of R, and every connected subset of R is an interval, so f of A is an interval, okay. All right. Why is it called intermediate value theorem? Because we can say that since f of A is an interval, okay, what we can say is that suppose there are any two points, let us say x and y belong to f of A, and x, let us say, and x less than y, okay, and suppose there exists some z, x less than z less than y, then this should imply that z also belongs to f of A, okay, z also belongs to f of A, okay. So in other words, if f takes the value x and y, x y belongs to f of A means what, there exists some A such that f of A equal to x, and y belongs to f of A means what, there exists some B such that f of B is equal to y, that is, let us say, that is f of A is equal to x, that is, there exists a b in A such that f of A is equal to x and f of B is equal to y. That means the function f assumes the values x and y. If it does that, okay, it should assume all the values in between those two values, okay, or all the values which are intermediate, okay. That is why it is called intermediate value theorem, okay. So if f assumes any two real numbers, it assumes all the values which are in between those two values, okay. So for example, in particular, suppose at some point f of A is less than 0 and at some other point f of B is bigger than 0, then there should exist some point C such that f of C is equal to 0, okay. So this is something that is used fairly often again in numerical analysis in finding the first approximation of any roots of the equations, okay. So intermediate value theorem is again quite useful in basically deciding the starting points of many of the numerical algorithms, okay. And usually in applications, this function f will go from some subset of R to R, and that subset will usually be an interval, okay. That subset will be usually an interval. So image of an interval under a continuous function will always be an interval, okay. And this also answers, for example, certain kinds of functions cannot exist. For example, can there exist a continuous function from R to N, let us say continuous and onto, is that possible? Let us say, is it possible if, let us say f from R to N, f from R to N continuous and onto? Is that possible? Because obviously the intermediate value property will be violated, okay, right? N is not an interval, okay. N is not an interval, so there cannot exist any continuous function going from R to N, okay, right. So such a thing is not possible, okay. Alright, now next we want to see how the operations on this connected sets take place, okay. For example, we would like to know what about the intersections and unions of connected sets, okay. It is something similar to the intervals, okay. We have seen that intersection of any two intervals will again be an interval, okay. But union need not be. In case of union, what we know, that union will be an interval if the intersection is non-empty, okay. Something similar is true for the connected sets also, okay. That is, if you take two connected sets and if their intersection is non-empty, then their union is again connected, okay. And this is true not only for two sets, but it is true for any family of sets, okay. I will just state that theorem and then we shall see the proof tomorrow, okay. So suppose XD is a metric space. And let us say that AI, small I belonging to big I, let us say I is some indexing set, okay, is a family of connected subsets, okay, is a family of connected sets in X. Of course, such that their intersection is non-empty, okay, such that intersection AI, I belong to I, is non-empty, okay. Then we want to say that then union AI, I belonging to I, is connected. Alright, we shall see the proof of this theorem in tomorrow's class.